Okay, thanks for letting me know. Okay, so we need these things for the base year as well as for the future year. Some of them may be forecasted. Okay, obviously for the base year, for the existing situation, you can collect this data, okay, from different sources, or you can go onto the field and collect it yourself. And for the future year, you have to forecast it using models and equations. Okay. So mainly the future demand, okay, is calculated by using traffic growth factors. So whatever the pattern of traffic we have, whatever the growth pattern of traffic we have, we forecast it for the future year by using the current trend, okay, by projecting the current trend towards the future. For example, let's say I draw a graph between the year, okay, and traffic, and the shape of the graph is like this, for example. Okay, so let's say this is your current year. Okay, so for future, let's say I want the graph to project traffic in this year. Okay, so this is, let's say, 10 years after today. So I would simply project the graph like this. Okay, so give me future traffic. So the current trend will be extrapolated towards the future. Okay, now I just showed you the example from the graph, but normally you use traffic growth factor. So you see in past how or what was the rate of growth of traffic, and you apply the same rate of growth to the future as well. So if in the past, for the past 10 years, the traffic is growing 1% every year, so you apply the same factor, 1%, for the next 5 or 10 years as well. Okay. So how do you know the traffic growth factors? Okay, for traffic growth factors, you again have some equations, or you can borrow the factors from other transportation models. Okay, other similar transportation models. For example, you in some other city, they are using a growth factor of 2%, and you feel that city is similar to your city, you can use the same factor. Okay, or you are designing a highway and you need a growth factor for that, and there's a similar highway designed in the same city, you may take the factor from that. Okay, so you can calculate it for your own highway using the equations, or you can use a similar project or a data from any similar project. Okay, so traffic counts, now we will deal with each of the traffic data which we need, and we will focus on traffic counts. Okay, we'll focus on traffic count because this is the most important part of data collection for transportation planning. So traffic counts are factual information. Factual means it cannot be estimated. It has to be something real. Okay, it has to be something real. I'm talking about existing traffic counts for the existing year. It has to be factual, means it should be real. Okay, existing traffic counts cannot be calculated. It can only come from the road network itself. Okay, so traffic counts give you how much load will there be on the road network. Okay, load in terms of the load on the pavement, as well as load in terms of traffic, how many vehicles. Okay, normally traffic counts are collection of traffic counts is the duty of the state agencies and the government departments, like in Bahrain, Ministry of Works collect traffic data. Traffic Directorate also collects traffic data. Okay, so they collect traffic data and they have them with you, they have them, and you can take it from them if you are involved in any project related to their jurisdiction. So these traffic counts will contain what? They will tell you the variations in traffic in different times of the year. Okay, like different months of the year. Okay, or different times of the day. So within a day, how much the traffic is changing. Okay, and it should also tell you the distribution of vehicle types or weights. Okay, so how many vehicles you had of each type, how many passenger cars, how many trucks, how many buses, and so on and so forth. Okay, and then within trucks and buses, you may have different categories based upon their weights. Okay, so you have trucks of 200 pounds, then 250 pounds, and so on and so forth. So based upon that, the traffic count should give you a classified, we call it the classified count. Okay, classified traffic count. Okay, so classified means that it is classified on the basis of different categories of vehicles. So this should be included in the traffic count. Then traffic counts can be taken using temporary or permanent counters. Okay, So temporary counters include pneumatic road tube, and we have talked about them in the traffic engineering course. These are thin rubber tube of black color, and you can still see them on many highways. Okay, like the few you have mentioned here, near to any new development or the highways on which they are doing some maintenance or construction, normally they take traffic counts there. Okay, but other types of counters are also there. Microwave counters, okay, so they work on microwave radiation. They have a transmitter and a receiver. Transmitter at one side of the road, receiver on the other side of the road. Whenever a vehicle passes, it will disrupt the microwave rays, and vehicle is counted. Okay, or you can have video counters as well. There are counters available like cameras. Okay, they work like cameras. Okay, so the video is recorded, and the counter has the ability to detect the vehicle from the video. You have to do some calibration. It has the ability. Once you do the calibration, it can tell you how many vehicles of each type has passed in the video. Okay, and there are some softwares available as well. If you come with the video, put in the software. Okay, if you search for image detection, you'll find many programs and softwares, and you can use them for the same purpose. Insert the video, the software or the program will detect the vehicles from the video. Or you have permanent counters as well. Okay, normally these permanent counters are installed at signals in Bahrain. Okay, intersections. So temporary counters may be used to record average travel pattern, because temporary means that you will install it for a few days, then you will take it out. So you cannot, so it's not for, the complete year. So you try to get the average travel pattern. The average means the most usual routine. Okay, average here means the usual routine traffic pattern. Okay, and that's it. Okay, with permanent counters, you are getting the data for the whole year. You're getting the data for the whole year because it is permanent. So they are installed at key locations. Okay, the very important locations, locations which have high traffic. Okay, or locations which have many important highways crossing or merging each other. Okay, and those locations put permanent counters. So like I said, many intersections. Then these permanent counters are used to generate adjustment factors for season, month and time. So we have used again the adjustment factors, the daily adjustment factors, the monthly adjustment factors. Okay, and even we use the hourly adjustment factors in traffic engineering course as well. When you're doing limited network study, statewide counting programs, so we use these adjustment factors. Okay, so these adjustment factors can be used to convert data from a small time frame to the whole year. Okay, that was the main idea. But if you want more details, you have to go back and look at the traffic engineering course. So these counts are used with future land use proposals. So what you are proposing for future, how the land use will change in that area to estimate future traffic volume. So this, we have the counts for now. Okay, we know their pattern for now. And then we say, okay, now in this area, I'm going to build a new mall, or in this area, I'm going to build a new housing project. Okay, so how these counts will change, okay, for future. Normally your time frame for now, we are not talking about traffic impact analysis. Okay, we are talking about planning in general. Okay, so we are talking about the development of the whole area. Okay, so in that case, when you are not doing the planning or impact analysis for any specific facility, then your time frame is normally 10 to 12, 20 years after the beginning of the construction. Okay, so whatever you are constructing in that area, a new highway, a mall or something, you are the authority. Okay, now you are the government department who is thinking about the transportation planning of the whole area. Okay, not about a specific facility, but you need to start from somewhere. So you start from maybe today, and from today onwards, 10 to 20 years, or whatever facility you will start in that area, that will change the land use. Okay, you are doing planning because something is about to change, right? Otherwise, this planning process is not required. You can just simply say, okay, the traffic will keep on increasing with this rate. If nothing is changing, then you can assume that it will continue in the same way it is going on now. So something is changing. So from that change, from the beginning of that change, the construction, to the next 10, 20 years. Okay. So you are trying to estimate traffic for the next 10 to 20 years. And you may remember that I told you for traffic impact analysis, it is less than that. When you are talking about a specific facility, then the time frame is mainly up to 5 years. Okay. Okay. ADT. ADT stands for what? Can somebody tell me? ADT stands for what? ADT.
Average daily traffic.
Okay, great. Okay, so average daily traffic is required. It's the most commonly used measure of traffic. Okay, how much daily traffic you have? Okay, in a normal day, how much traffic you have in a normal day? So this is the volume of traffic which is moving in both directions. Okay, and it's the most average traffic of the day. Okay, and day means 24 hours. Okay, so you take traffic count for some few days, okay, repeated traffic count for a few days, and then you calculate an average. Okay, that will be ADT. So you do it for 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, and then you take the average, that will become ADT. Now ADT, you can see here they are using the word short periods because it is for less than 1 year. Anything less than 1 year is considered as a short period. And it, from that, you will only get ADT. And if you want to convert it to AADT, okay, now this extra A, extra A means what? The annual average daily traffic, okay? So ADT was average daily traffic and the extra A is for annual. So if you want to convert it to the daily traffic of the whole year, then you need to apply this, okay? Basically, you need the volume of all the 365 days of the year. Okay, so this is summation of volume taken on day I of month J, and K is the number of times this day has come. Okay, K is the number of times the day has come. Okay, so Monday, for example, in a year, normally one day comes 52 or 53 times. In 1 year, you have 52 or 53 weeks. So each day, like you have 52 weeks and then few extra days. So Monday may have come 52 times, Tuesday may have come 53 times, and so on and so forth. So K is the number of times a day has come in the year. Okay, so volume of that day of day I of the month J, and K is number of times it has come. So you basically, you are saying take the volume of all the days in the year and add them. Okay, so this is volume of each day for each month and for each 7 days of the week. Okay, so you add them and then you take the average, so it will be AADT. Okay, you can see they are taking the average, okay, 1 by 12, 1 by 7, 1 by n. This is to take the average. Okay, so you do the summation, then divide by the number, do the summation of 12 months, divide by 12. The summation of 7 weeks of the day and divide by seven. So this will give you AADT. So for AADT, basically you need to take the whole year. For ADT, you can take it for less than 1 year. For AADT, you need to take the whole year. Okay, this is a simple chart, which is a simple diagram, which is showing you AADT at different locations in North Carolina state. Okay, and now, good thing about US Departments of Transportation is that they have digitalized most of their data. Okay, so if you go to the websites of any state Department of Transportation for USA, you will find traffic counts, you will find highway classification with maps like this. So it's very open. For them, they have made it very open. So it's a good learning activity for us. Okay, you want to see something, so that's why they can use it, you know, openly in the books. Okay, you will not find these examples maybe for other countries. Okay, they are taking something from the State Department and are putting in the book. Okay, but you can find it very commonly in the books of USA because their data is very open. Okay, so I would advise you go to any Department of Transportation from USA and you can have a look, okay, at the data. So this is the data which is required for planning process. So this is the reason they have made it open so that other people can use it. Other people can use it. By other people, I mean other departments related to transportation planning. So they don't have to bother them. Give us this, give us that. They will tell them, go to the website, take it, okay. Now for planning, ADT and AADT are used, but for design, we use design hourly volume and directional design hourly volume. Okay, mainly we use directional design hourly volume. Okay, and these volumes are used for the design criteria as well, selecting the design criteria as well. So first of all, design hourly volume is normally taken as the 30th highest hourly volume out of the count of the 365 days of the year. Okay, so it will be over 90%. Okay, it will cover like more than 90% of the hours of the year. If you take the 30th hour of the day, 30th hour of the year, then it will cover more than 90% hours of the year. Okay, and just to give an idea, I've discussed in traffic and highway as well, but I will not let anything go by without any explanation. So on the y-axis you have percentage of traffic coming in each hour, and on the x-axis you have the hour itself. Okay, which hour was it in the order of its percentage. So the highest, the hour with the highest percentage will be the first hour. Okay, the hour with the highest percentage will be the first hour. Okay, and the one after that will be the second and the third and the fourth and so on. Okay, so you come to this and you plot your hours like this. Okay, it will be a graph like this. And then from the x-axis, so you have plotted in descending order, the percentages in descending order. So the highest one is the first hour. So then you come to the x-axis. Okay, and find out the 30th hour here. And whatever percentage you get from here, you multiply this percentage with ADT to get design hourly volume. Okay, so this is basically the K factor. Okay, this percentage is basically the K factor. So you have ADT and you have data for different hours of the day for the whole year. You plot it in descending order, find out the 30th, the percentage of traffic coming in the 30th hour, and that will become your K. Okay, and if you are taking the 30th hour, it is taking more than or taking care of more than 90% of the hours of the year. Okay, because you are covering more than 90% of the hours, right? You're only leaving how many hours? 29 hours. Okay, only 29 hours have more percentage than this one. All the other hours have either equal to K or less percentage of traffic. Okay, so you are covering more than 90% of the hours. Then if you want to convert DHV into directional design hourly volume, then you should multiply D with D. What is D? D is the percentage of traffic coming in each hour. So ADT was combined. AADT and ADT is the combined volume of both directions. Okay, but DDHV is the directional design hourly volume, which is for each direction or in the peak direction. Okay, the peak direction. Obviously, both directions may not have same traffic. So we are interested in the traffic which is coming in the peak direction. Okay, so you have to multiply DHV further with D, and D is the directional design, directional distribution factor. So K was the percentage of traffic coming in the 30th peak hour, and D is the percentage of traffic coming in the peak direction. Okay, so DHV is ADT into K, and DDHV is DHV into D. Okay, so if you combine both of them in the equation of DDHV, then DHV is ADT into K, so AD into K, and then multiply by D. Okay, now if you do not have detailed traffic counts for your area, so you cannot plot this graph or you cannot find the value of D, then you can take these values for as an assumption. Okay, so these are considered as average normal values for K and D. So K 10% and D 60%. Okay. For rural areas, it's normally higher, but you know, 10 is like an average. Okay. And again, D can be more than 60% as well and less than 60% as well, but 60 is an average. Okay. So if data is not given, then you can take values, take these values. Okay. Now, so we have the following traffic counts given for an urban freeway, and we want to find out ADT, DHV, and DDHV. Okay. We have to find out ADT, DHV, and DDHV. First of all, we start with the calculation of ADT. So ADT, you are given data for 5 days. You take their average and it will become ADT. Okay. So give me the ADT. Go ahead. Give me ADT. If you want to like say, you can say to me, I will type it. No problem. If you want to send me as a message, go ahead. These are the values. Like I said, you can have the slides open in front of you as well. Go ahead. Give me ADT.
Is it 2060?
2060, I don't know. Maybe.
Yes.
Okay. So AET is 2060. Okay. I will write it here. ADT 2060 vehicles per day. If somebody asks a different answer, then you can let me know. Then we want to find out DHV. So DHV is 2060 multiplied by the K factor. The K factor is given 0.12. Okay. Now K factor is written in front of day three. It doesn't matter. Okay. K factor is written in front of day three, or it doesn't matter. Okay. So K and D, even if they are recorded for some other period of time for the same highway, it doesn't matter. You can still use it. Okay, so if they say 55% directional distribution or K was 12%, okay, on day three, you can assume that it will remain the same for all the other days. Okay, so it doesn't matter. You can still use it. Okay, so give me the value of DHV now.
247.
Now, what will be the units? Vehicles per
day.
No, vehicles per hour.
Okay.
Okay, because you multiply with the proportion of traffic coming in each hour, right? So you convert it to per hour now. Okay, now DDHV. So DDHV will be 247, okay, multiplied by 0.55. Okay, or if you want to calculate it directly, then we can do it like this as well. This is also fine, that you take 2060 multiplied by 0.12. multiplied by 0.55. This is also fine. Okay, you can calculate directly or in the steps, because in the question they asked me for DHV separately, so I'm calculating DHV separately. Okay, give me the value of this.
$136. Yeah.
Okay, 136, and the units are vehicles per what?
Per hour, Victor.
Per hour. Yeah, because you just calculated how much is coming in the peak direction. You did not do anything with the time. Okay, so these are the values. I hope these are correct. Okay, you can check it. Simple multiplication. Okay, moving on. Another example here as well. Now they are saying compute DDHV for each movement. So in the figure, they are showing ADT, Okay, so these values are ADT. So we don't have to calculate ADT. ADT is directly given. We have to calculate DDHV. Okay, DDHV. And the K value is given. The K value is given. Now, for DDHV, I need two factors, right? I need K and D. So K is given, D is not given. Why? What should I do with D?
From where should I get? We should get it, right, doctor?
We should give it.
Anybody else? From the total movement, maybe we can.
Okay. Get your idea. Okay. Can you explain what do you mean here? You're on the right track. How are we supposed to get D?
The directions are already given.
The directions are already given. So the traffic is already given for each direction. D was the directional distribution factor. So if I already give you how much traffic exactly coming in each direction, then you don't need the D factor. Okay, then you don't need the D factor. Okay, now one more thing which will help you in further analysis, you can see how they have marked the directions. See southbound, where is southbound? Where they have mentioned southbound? Upward. Why upward? Because southbound means going towards south. Okay, this is how they normally mark the directions on the intersection. They mark it in the other direction, they say going towards where. Okay, so southbound means going towards south, westbound means going towards west. Okay, so going towards west means it is in the east. Okay, and you can see it in the figure. So keep this in mind. Okay, so let us calculate these values here. Okay, start with southbound. Okay, southbound, I have straight and I have, what is this? Left running, right? So southbound straight, how much is it? It will be 583 multiplied by 0.1. Okay, so it should be easy. 58, right? 58 meters per hour. Okay, meters per hour. Then, southbound southbound left, it will be 179 into 0.1. okay, so 179 is 17.9, which is almost 18 vehicles per hour. Okay, and then we have, let's say we have westbound. Westbound is only one. So 680 into 0.1 will give you 68 vehicles per hour. Then we have northbound. Northbound is straight. Okay, so straight will be 525 into 0.1, so that will make it, let's take, 52.5, so it will be, let's take it 53, okay? And I'm just rounding off, okay? One vehicle plus or minus doesn't make much difference. Even if you take 52, it will not make much difference, okay? Then northbound right turn, okay, so it will be 242 0.1, it will be 24, okay, per hour. And then we have eastbound, we have straight, so 638 0.1. It will be 63.8, which I will take it as 64 vehicles per hour. And eastbound, this will be left turn, left, 259, multiplied by 0.1, so it will be 25.9, which I will take as 26 vehicles per hour. Okay, now final question for this example, what are the units of these numbers? The numbers which are given, 583, 179, 680, what are the units for them? They are vehicles per what? Vehicles per hour, vehicles per day, what?
Per day.
Per day, yeah, because they are ADT, okay? Most of the times, if you keep the units in mind, you will make your life easier, the calculations will become much easy. Okay, so we have the DDHP is the peak hour traffic for which we will design, okay? So we call it the peak hour volume, and if I give you a highway, if I tell you this is the highway and go and take traffic, then you will take the traffic for the peak hour, okay? And we will call it the peak hour volume, which basically means the volume, the highest hourly volume on any day, okay? On any day, whatever the highest hourly volume you assume, that will become the peak hour volume. Normally, some highways, highways have different peak hour volumes for AM and PM, okay? And sometimes there is a afternoon peak hour as well, okay? In Bahrain, they consider these three, okay? They call it AM, PM, and evening peak hours, okay? So evening basically for them means the evening means the evening, but the PM means the afternoon, okay? The afternoon, okay? So because in different times of the day, different directions may have the peak hours, okay? And maybe in the morning, the peak hour is because of the school traffic. In the afternoon, it is because of something else in the area, okay? Or maybe because of schools as well. And in the evening, it may be because of office. So in three different hours, different directions may have peak hours, or maybe the peak hour traffic is changing because of different activities, okay? So although it should be the highest hourly volume, but because of the changes in direction, changes in activities, so we take them separately so that we can design for that, okay? So if I have a highest value in the AM time, I know this value is because of this activity. If I have the highest value in the evening time, I know this is for this activity. So planning becomes easier if I know why people are coming towards this area. So that's why peak hour volumes can be two, in some cases, three as well in the day. Now, within the hour, traffic is not uniform, okay? So if you tell me, 600 vehicles passed in 1 hour. So 660 minutes, right? 660 minutes. Does it mean 10 vehicles per minute? No. Maybe in the first few minutes, 200 vehicles have passed. Okay, maybe in the first 5 minutes, 200 vehicles have passed. And the remaining 55 minutes, 400 vehicles passed. Okay, so the traffic flow was not the same within the hour. Okay, and there was an example which we did last time in traffic course. If you don't take care of this variation within the hour, then you can create a traffic jam, okay? So to account for this variation within the hour, we have a factor which is the PHF. PHF stands for? PHF stands for what?
Peak hourly volume.
PHF.
Peak hour factor.
Peak hour factor, yes, yes. Okay, I'm just trying to cross out which questions I shouldn't give you in the exam. Okay, so be attentive. So peak hour factor, you know. So we have this peak hour factor, how to calculate the peak hour factor. So whatever peak hour volume you get, you divide it with peak hour factor to account for the variation within the hour. If you don't divide by the peak hour factor, then the volume which you are designing for will not account for the variation within the hour. It will become insufficient for design. Okay, so peak hour volume is peak hour factor is peak hour volume, the actual volume, upon 4 times the highest 15 minutes volume. So within the hour, you have 15 minutes interval, and then the highest 15 minutes interval should be taken in the denominator, okay, and then you multiply by 4. The 15 minutes, okay, they are calling it volume, actually, they should call it flow. They were calling it flow here. So this is 15 minute value. Let me put it this way. This is 15 minute traffic value, okay? For hour, we call it volume, but 15 minutes traffic value, and then you multiply by 4, okay? So that you get the peak hour factor. The peak hour factor can range from 0.25 to 1, okay? and there is something which they have written here. So if peak hour factor is higher, that means the traffic was distributed more evenly within the hour. The traffic flow was uniform within the hour. If peak hour factor is lower, that means the traffic was varying. Peaking means varying. Okay, peaking means we are using the word peaked. Peak means it varied a lot. Okay, the traffic varied or peaked a lot. Okay, that's not the peaking like you peak into something. Okay, this is peaking like going up. Okay, going up. Okay, let us do very quickly three examples here. I'm sure you will not take much time to do these examples, and it will tell you the range. Okay, so we have this volume flow for each 15 minutes in the hour from 7 to 8. Okay, and you can see it is same. The flow is same. Okay, so no variation at all. No variation at all. So if you calculate peak hour volume, it will be 250 into 4, right? And it will be 1000 vehicles per hour. Okay, and if you find out the highest 15 minute flow, it will be 250 because this is the value you have, okay, and only vehicles. Then if you calculate the peak hour factor, it will be 1000 divided by, according to the formula, 4 times 250, and it will give you how much? It will give you 1, and this is the highest value of peak hour factor. The highest value of peak hour factor is 1, and this value will be achieved if you can see the reason. If the flow doesn't change in any 15 minutes interval, all 15 minutes interval carry the same flow, then peak hour factor will be 1. Let us look at another example. Okay, again, same hour, but the volume is coming in the first 15 minutes and the remaining 15 minutes have 0. Okay, now if you calculate the peak hour volume, it will be 1000 because only 1000 value is there, the remaining are 0. So 1000 plus 0 plus 0 plus 0. Highest 15 minutes volume or 15 minutes flow, 1000. Sorry, not hour, 1000. Okay, because there's no other flow here. And if you calculate the peak hour factor, then it will be 1000 divided by 4 times 1000. So 1000 will be cancelled out, and 1 by 4 will be 0.25. So 0.25. And this is the minimum value of peak hour factor. This is the minimum value of peak hour factor. And how do you get it? How do you get the minimum value? When the flow is concentrated only in, or the volume is concentrated only one interval. Okay. So when the volume was divided equally in all the 15 minutes interval, you got the highest value, which was 1. When the volume is concentrated only one interval, you got the lowest value, which is 0.25. And this is an example which is for the normal case. Okay, so can somebody give me the values for this example? I will just open give me the values for this example. What will be the peak hour volume here? What is the summation of these four values? Give me the peak hour volume. It will be 240 plus 310 plus 270 plus 180. How much is it?
1000.
Okay. Per hour. Okay. Then the highest 15 minutes value flow?
310.
Then the peak hour factor will be 1000 divided by 4 times 310, and it will be how much?
0.81.
Okay. 81? 81. 0.81?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So this is how you calculate the peak hour factor, and you see this is normal variation of traffic, okay? So there's no extraordinary thing here. Normally traffic varies like this, okay? So normally you will have a peak hour factor which is 0.82, close to 1, but not exactly 1. 1 is an exceptional case. Okay, so I will stop here and I'll go for the attendance.